believe you are live.
There we go. Look at that. A white-backed vulture in the pre-dawn darkness. And unfortunately, this vulture is not sitting up top a lion kill. I think it just chose this wonderful dead tree to schnooze in last night. And it's one of my favorite dead trees. It is a leadwood. Now, believe it or not, these dead trees can remain standing for over 100 years once they've died. And the wood is so dense, if you dropped it into a swimming pool, it would sink to the bottom. A bit like our final control team. Only joking, of course. Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. My name is Brent Yeosmith. I have Dangerous Dave, the objectified dish, and a dish he is on camera. He's trying not to laugh at the moment. But this morning, you have myself and Tayla to take you on the most amazing adventure in the African bush. Now, Tayla has just joined us, so I think it's time to put her on the test. So we're going to be having a birding competition between both vehicles this morning. And of course, we've already got one up with the white-backed vulture. And I'm just listening. We can hear lots of birds, we can't see any. And hopefully today, the elusive white-throated robin will make an appearance, but we're going to have to go down towards the Mwati River to find that. But first things first, I'm going to be looking for some lions that I heard roaring in this area at about 3:30 this morning. No lions, just a grey go-away bird. Well, thank you to Lucy and Kevin, who saw a Birmingham boy at the pan last night. Now, we also saw a Birmingham boy last night. Dave thought it was a waterbuck. It wasn't actually Dave. I think it was Rebecca who said it was a waterbuck. And it was the head ranger from Arethusa's birthday last night. So we went out on a little social occasion. But on our way home, we did see a Birmingham walking towards the pan. I'm just listening to the radio. I'm really hoping those lions start their call. But anyway, if they're no lions, we're birding and birding properly. So the record for a sunrise safari, I think, is 32 bird species. We aim to beat that, and we challenge Tayla to try. Now, Tayla has got the other killer bee. So it's B versus B. So it's T and B versus B and D.
Right.
Yeah, so we'll see who comes out trumps today, and it's going to be very exciting. I'm ecstatic to have you on the vehicle with us, and welcome to your own privately guided safari. Now remember, we are live, we can take questions. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or send an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Keep those final control ladies busy. Let's carry on. Hopefully we've got some lion cubs around the next corner. We are on Juma Private Game Reserve at the moment, heading towards the north on a beautiful little road called Inyala Road North. We're heading towards the Buffalo's Hook Waterhole, a favourite hangout of the Nkuhuma pride. Now, as we continue on, let's go across to Tayla and see if her and Brian are up to the challenge for the birds.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to a very, it's not too chilly this morning, it's a bit fresh, Safari Sunrise Drive. So my name is Tayla, for those of you that don't know me, and this morning, behind the camera, we've got Brian, aka the Thumb. Look at him, looking all smart in his dinnerware for breakfast. That's very, very hipster-like, doing the complete opposite. So I hope you are all well this morning. And I believe Brent has challenged me to a game of birds. Aha, Well, he's one up already. I haven't seen anything just yet. I don't think most of them have quite woken up, but I'm going to be sitting, listening, waiting for the dawn chorus. I cannot wait for that. And hopefully we'll find a nice little bird party where we can just sit and we can count the birds, maybe get 5 or 6 in one go. That'd be really nice. So last night, I also believe Brent reminded you about the lion waterbuck story. There's a lot of confusion as to who shouted waterbuck. It was not me. I can clearly tell the difference. My eyesight is good and I eat my carrots. And so basically what we're doing is I'd really like to just checking the cut line, just want to make sure if he hasn't crossed out. He was beautiful, so I did get to finally see my first Birmingham, even though it was in the dark. So we're gonna carry on along here, just heading relatively slowly, just making sure I'm not missing any tracks, otherwise I don't want to waste my time tracking an animal that's not even on the property. And we heard them vocalizing quite a bit last night, so he was looking for somebody. Also, it's maybe a good idea just to keep an eye to see if the Nkuhumas have maybe crossed back into our traverse. Come on, birds, 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 birds. Ah, but I believe Brent has got another one. He's 2 up.
Well, Tayla was mentioning she wanted a bird party. We, of course, have already found one. And there we go, a puff-backed shrike, or in the current, with the new names, the black-backed puffback, which is the most ridiculous name ever given to a bird, since it has a very white back when it puffs it up. Oh, he's flown off. And let's just have a look what else. We've got quite a lot of birds calling around us. We have the coffee tea or me. Coffee tea or me, which is an orange-breasted bushshrike. Let's just listen. Incoming. Right towards us. Oh, it is a scimitable. A common scimitable, number 3 on our list. And you can see the rapier-like bill that is used to pry under bark and into little holes in the wood. Very thin beak, specially designed. Now, from all the animals out here, evolution is probably most apparent in the various types of birds we have, with their different bills, different wing spans, different feathers, specifically designed. Whoop, off it pops. Anyway, I think that's a good start, Dave. What are we on? No. 3. So we've got a black-backed puffback, a common scimitable. Okay, I was about to start just to go there, into that gardenia. I saw an interesting bird land there. Oh, it's the puffback again, but have a look as he turns his back, he's puffed. Oh, now he's obviously unpuffed his puffed back. Oh, off he goes. Oh, another tree. Another bird landed in the same tree. A little bit to the right. Oh, there's a battle going on. A little bit to the left. And there's the puffback, but it was chasing another bird. There, oh, the other bird has escaped. Oh, there's a puffback again. So, the record for a sunrise foray is 32 species. We have 29 to go. Now, of course, we're not going to say no to any big cats while we're searching. And I'm hoping the Nkuhumas have come back from their visiting in the north. Now, it sounds like someone is jumping ahead of me and taking my sneaky spots. So, we're about 400 meters from Buffalzook Dam, but it seems like someone else beat me there. So, let's go have a look.
Look what I've found. I've got some turtle doves, which are hysterically funny birds. There's 4 of them, but unfortunately, they only count as one. So far I'm on one bird, which is wonderful. And we also came around here just to check it to see if we couldn't pick up on any lions, but we haven't. So we're going to carry on looking around to see what else we can find. Lovely little turtle doves. I was saying to you yesterday how they've got the most interesting call. If they would only call for us, they might either work harder, or more lager, more lager. But let's let these doves meander along and carry on with their day. And we are going to carry on. I can hear some more birds. And listen, let's see if we can find out who's shouting over here. But it's quite thick. Oh, here, hang on. We've got there. I think we've got a tawny flanked prinia. Can you see it? Just on the... Are we on it? Ah, there we go. Yes, hello. Hello, little one. But we're getting there. Slowly, and it's gone. Number two. What else can we get here? Yeah. It seems like there is maybe a little bird party here. Can hear lots of noises. Lots of chatting away. But no one really showing their face. Let's go on a little bit further. And let's see. Ooh, we've got some... Sounds like Natal Spurfiles shouting in the distance. Let's see if we can find one. Ah, that's interesting. Brian, you obviously ate your carrots last night. Look at all of that. Look at all those vultures up on the tree. So those mainly look like white-backed vultures, which I believe Brent has already got. But I suppose we can still add it to our list. And that's quite interesting. I wonder why there are so many of them, and now they're flying. There are. FZ, thank you, Kirsty, for allowing me. That is an unusual amount of vultures. Let's see if they're flying now. Let's see if they land close by. Maybe we need to go and try and have a closer view to see what's happening there. Vultures, they do roost in the evenings, so that's not common, but there's so many of them. And when they flew, they didn't fly away. They've just flown to the next tree. And if you see, there's still some that are perched up. Maybe let's go have a closer look. Maybe there is something down there. We did have that male lion vocalizing quite a bit. So possibly, maybe he's made a kill. Maybe it's not even anything. Maybe he's just sleeping. Rightio, while I go bundu bashing and see and do a bit of investigating, let's go and see what Brent has to loo.
Well, of course, I'm one step ahead of Tayla. I'm already off the car. So all those vultures Taylor's looking at are down in the drainage line. We've actually disturbed some of them. They've flown. So what I'm going to do is say, let Taylor find you some birds. I'm going to go try and pull a cat out of the drainage line by its tail. So I'm going to go for a walk. I think there's enough vultures that warrants a bit of interest. So the Nkuhumas were really hungry when I last saw them, and they didn't catch anything last night. Apparently they, oh sorry, yesterday they caught a very small buffalo. Little baby, which didn't provide much food. So I'm hoping they are lying not far from where I'm standing right at this very moment with a large buffalo. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go have a walk, see if I'm lucky enough to get growled at. So if we get growled at, it probably means we're going to find the lions. And of course, we're going to keep looking for birds at the same time. But while I go see if I can find a cat on foot, let's go back to Tayla, who's of course following me around this morning.
Brent, you know, I've just heard all these wonderful stories about you and how all the viewers just absolutely love you. So I can hear Brent talking just ahead. I don't think he's seen these two birds that we have. Ah, are you kidding me? They were perched so nicely. We did actually have a drongo and a Cape Glossy Starling, and they have now both flown away, so we'll have to find some more. So I think we're gonna probably just go past Brent's vehicle, just bypass him very quickly, and we're gonna take a different route and just check a few roads. I reckon the vultures that we were obviously looking at, this is exactly the same vultures that Brent was looking at, and I think he's got the same idea that I have. Hopefully he picked up some tracks along with all that vulture activity, which would hopefully be a bit more positive. So for those of you who are just joining in, remember we are live in the African bush. Oh, I've just got to stop my trail of thought. We've got David. Hello, David. Oi. How are you? You're looking very fresh this morning. So we've got James following up on those vultures, which is fantastic. That's great. I don't feel like getting dusty this morning, so I'll try and stay clean because I'm usually the very dirty one. But like I was saying, so we are actually live right now, so you may even hear me sneeze, you may even hear me cough if you're not convinced. And if you'd like to send us a message or comment, please do. We encourage it. You can either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or if you want to email, email's still good. We're not quite living in the Stone Ages anymore, so you can send in an email to questions@wildearth.tv. I see Brian has got something. Brian, what do you have? Oh, a black-headed oriole. Let me sneak forward a little bit. And I think, can you get him there? Or should... Oh, look. Oh, and he's calling so beautifully. Look at that beautiful black-headed oriole. I think he's going to call a typical. Wait. He's still chatting. He's just flown to the next bush. You're actually going to have an even better view of him now. I'm not going to say too much. I just want you to hear how unbelievable and fluid this call is. So, where did he go now? Oh, he's on the bottom branch of that quarry tree. Look at that, look at that. Come on, call for us again. If he doesn't, I can always play the call. Not while he's here, I don't want to upset him. They're quite territorial birds. FC's gonna have to help me. I've forgotten how many birds I have. I think I'm on four. Oh, listen to that. We're ahead. Apparently Brent is only on three and he's off the vehicle. I think this is a perfect opportunity to gain some momentum and get ahead while he's disadvantaged and on foot. Let's leave this oriole. Let's move on because I can see a few more birds flying. What do we have? Who have we got flying over there? Let's try and get a little bit closer. Looks like some green wood hoopoes, and they never like to sit still. Here we go. You see, there's one, two, three. I saw four of them, and I did see something else as well. What else is hopping? I'm gonna have a look at the binoculars very quickly. Is it a grey-headed bushrat? Yes, it is. Do you see that to the left? Go to the left a little bit. Where are you now? He's hopping down. Yeah, go down and then zoom if you go in a bit closer. He's just to the right. There we go. That looks like a grey-headed bushrat. Maybe it's an orange-breasted. I just want to double check. I haven't seen an orange-breasted for a very long time. So I'm just going to quickly look in my book. Actually, I have got an app. Let me look on my app. So while you have a look at these beautiful birds. So now we are on six birds. And how wonderful is that? Let me just apologize. I just want to very quickly check. I've been on holiday and I've forgotten what birds look like. B for bushrike. That would maybe help me. Let me just double check. I think it actually could be an orange-breasted. Is he hiding behind the trees?
Yeah.
Let me go forward a little. I just want to quickly confirm which bush shrike that is because I didn't get a great view because they never sit still. I think actually I'm going to change my mind. Just by the size and the beak wasn't as robust. I think that was an orange-breasted bush shrike, but any bush shrike is good enough because you hardly ever see them. And to very quickly have a view of those green wood hoopoes was very nice too. Oh my goodness, we do actually have... Oh, there he is. Can you see him up there? Yes, we do have an orange-breasted bushrike. That's fantastic.
Oh, I lost him again.
Is he still just further to the left? Go down and to the left? Where did he go?
I think he flew.
Ah, okay. Well, yes, it was. He's going to the top of the tree. No, forward. You know these birds, they're so cheeky. They don't like to sit still, but we have got so many. We've now got drongos. And unfortunately, I think he's up top, jumping around on the top of the tree. Do you see that? Oh no, we've got someone else. Who do we have there? Is that a blackback puffback? Possibly. Can you see them just hopping? There's so many birds there. There we go. You gotta go center frame. Who's that? Yeah. No, southern black tit. That wasn't the one I was looking at though. We've got a southern black tit. FC, please, final control, help me out. I'm losing track because we've got so many birds. And then there was also something just to the tip top of the left. Can you see that? It's got a very, looks like it's maybe a crumbet. I didn't see that. I did not see that. Maybe a long-billed crumbeck or even a grey pendulum tit, but I didn't see that bird properly, unfortunately. Just as I looked at the monitor, it flew away. And I was saying, this grey cloudy sky, unfortunately, is not helping for the visual of the birds. It's not really giving their true colours. So it's actually not the greatest morning to do birding. Brent, setting me up to fail. We've got a drongo, though. You can see just at the base on this lovely knobthorn, who is flown away, which is nice. But we did have a drongo. That's the green wood hoopoe again hopping around, probing for any little insects or any boring beetles or grubs that may be in the bark of the tree or even in a little hole. We have got a puffback, I think. Oh no, that's our bushrike. That's our orange-breasted bushrike. Very nice. We're on a roll. I need to try and recap and do a count. So we started off, we saw turtle doves. Then we saw, what did we see next? We saw a tawny flanked prinia. And then we had vultures who are still coming in. So hopefully Brent's going to find something. And what else did we have after that? Then I did say we had a drongo and a Cape Glossy starling. But they flew away. And then we had a black-headed oriole, we had orange-breasted bushshrike, southern black tit, and I need to catch this drongo. Now, normally drongos are very, this is a vulture that is flying. I think it's most likely a white-backed. I cannot see very well now. Yes, white-backed. And actually, you could have seen that quite nicely as he landed like that. Yeah, when he had his wings spread open. I don't know if anybody managed to catch that very quick glimpse. See that lovely white patch on the back of the bird, which is obviously why they're called white-backed vultures. That was really nice little food party here. Let's carry on a little bit and see who else we can get. But the list is growing. Rachel from Israel, welcome to the morning show. Thank you so much for watching. So Rachel wants to know if there are quite a few birds in this area. Yes, as you can see, the food parties are fantastic. I'm not sure what the exact number or the count of birds in the northern Sabi Sands is, but I can imagine that it's probably at somewhere around maybe just under 300 birds. So say between 250 and 300 birds. I think we're very spoilt. And now you can see on your screens, we are looking at go away birds. How's that? It's always nice to see some go away birds. They used to be called grey luries, but I prefer their new name. As the name suggests, and maybe if we're lucky enough, they'll give us a little shout. They shout, go away, go away, when they don't like you. So they often say it to me. Here we go, off they fly. Normally these birds are always sunning themselves first things in the morning. And they like to eat fruit. So you'll often see them on the jackalberry trees at this time of the year, because they've got a little bit of fruit. Oh, this should actually be nice. Brian, are you feeling hungry yet?
Yeah.
Starving? Maybe
yeah,
starving. Absolutely famished. I think we will also, during the course of the day, if we're lucky enough, if we can beat the baboons and the monkeys and all the different birds, maybe we can find a few jackalberries that have dropped to the ground and that are still edible, in case there's no little worms and parasites. Though I suppose that's extra protein for you. We've got another white-backed vulture sitting up perched on the tree. That's actually nice. So Brett also mentioned to me, I suppose I should let you know about this too, is that he wants to do a little bit of a photo competition. Now, I wish we had a lovely blue sky, because this would have made for a lovely photo. And I'm going to repeat it like I have every morning so far. Remember, we are doing a calendar. We're doing a calendar and we are calling it Bums of Africa of Safari Live, or we can work on the title, but Bums of Africa has to be there, and we need to fit Safari Live in some way too. So if you've also got any name suggestions, please send them through. You can either hashtag Safari Live or questions@wildearth.tv. And the idea of this is, as the name suggests, Bums of Africa, is to take screenshots from your computer at home or from your cell phone, however you are watching the show, and the aim is to try and get pictures of their bums. So bird bums count too, but that's actually quite difficult. That'd be an interesting shot if we could get them, get a bird bum shot. Let's move on from this welcher and see what's down the road. Let's see if we can find another food party. And I believe that quite a few of you have actually been sending in some of your screenshots. So I don't know how we're going to do this. I'm still working on. We need to try and get it that we can put, everybody puts their pictures together and has a January to December. And maybe I always like to say, when I used to say that I wanted to do this calendar, is that the rangers should be December with their Christmas hats and bending over fully clothed though. It's not a nude calendar. So just for a good chuckle to throw the rangers in there. Right, where are the birds at? I'm not as good. Oh, hello, Inyala. My goodness. Look at you right here. How close is that? Hello. Sorry, I didn't even see you. Your camouflage is working well. Yeah. You don't look... You look like you haven't groomed yourself in a while, I'm afraid. She was so close. She's got her little one with her. A young female. And they're nibbling away. They found some greenery to munch on. You can see her coat is actually not looking that great. I don't know if you can see the adult so well. I just want to have a look, if you can maybe zoom in onto her neck. And you can see she's quite scraggly. Now, I don't know if that's just either for a lack of grooming, or if she's maybe got some form of a mite or something. You see there's a few patches of hair. Maybe it's a mange, but it doesn't look too serious. Maybe it's just because, unfortunately, with the drought at the moment, the animals seem to have been losing condition, and something like mange is probably the first thing that will go for an animal when it is not in its healthiest. So that's maybe what's happening there. But I suppose if she gave herself a good groom, she could cover it up as well. She'd probably look a little bit neater. She needs her daughter to help her and give her, do a bit of aloe grooming. You see that few little speckles on the legs. I love the Nyala. They always look like they're wearing shoes, little black shoes, little pointy shoes. The ballerinas of the bush. Just listening to the radio, it's quite interesting. It's very interesting. But while we were seeing all those vultures, I'm just going to stray away from the Nyala, and while we watch her, I'll tell you about what's going on. So it seems that they have picked up on some lion tracks. I'm not sure how many or who. Brent, I'm sure, will give a fantastic update. So I don't want to let on too much, but somewhere around where those vultures were. So I don't know if his walk has been too successful. I hope it has. It's always nice to see some of the big cats on drive. She actually looks fairly plump. Don't you think, Brian? Look at that belly. And I don't think it's food in there. I think that there's a little baby brewing. So I think maybe that's why her condition is also lacking, is because somebody is stealing all of her nutrients. And her coat, her lovely hair, she hasn't been able to go to the salon. Maybe she doesn't fit in the salon chair anymore. It's lovely. It was very nice of him to be so calm and so relaxed. You're going to come out again. I seem to be having a lot of luck with Inyala. I really wish I used to have this luck when I was guiding. It would have helped, because they're such beautiful animals to photograph, and often they would see me and they would turn and walk straight back into the thick bush. But I think it was yesterday maybe the morning before, where I had a lovely group of impala and Inyala walk straight in front of my vehicle. So we are, so I was very quickly mentioned, we're going to have a photo competition. So we're going to have to get Brent to go on about the photo competition a little bit more and where you'll be able to see our photos to decide on the winner. But Brent's back in the vehicle. Let's see if he's come, if he's got lucky. I hope he has, while I count the birds.
Got tracks of lions chasing buffalo all through this block. And I haven't been able to find them yet, but I'm on the trail. So what I'm hoping to hear is a little roar, a little growl. But of course, I haven't forgotten about the birding competition. I think Taylor's jumped up ahead of me while I've been tracking lions. Now I can hear some birds. Hear that? Right, there we go. Let me go back a bit. Way forward will work as well. It's running away.
Maybe not Franklin.
You got it?
No.
It's a Franklin, and it's old Franklin making that noise. Ah, no, it's disappeared. Well, I'm confident enough that we don't need that specific bird. So my plan is now to move around, and we are in the northern sectors of Juma at the moment, around a Buffalo's Hook waterhole. I'm 100% convinced the lion's in this block to the south of us. So I've got tracks heading north, chasing buffalo. And I'm just trying to make sure that they haven't come out the side. And the vultures were all down there, so I'm quite sure. I'm fingers crossed that they've caught something. But it could be closer to Hyena Road. So we're going to make our way across towards Hyena Road. And while we do that, Dave, how many birds do we need to stay in touch, you reckon? Two, three?
At least.
We're not too worried, though, as you can see. Here we go, there's one. There's a Birchall starling up in the tree. Or a silhouette of a Birchall starling. Now, every time I switch off the car, I'm listening. I'm just hoping to hear a little growls over a buffalo kill. Do you hear those other birds? I hear some other birds. There they are. You hear arrow-marked babblers. What's that now, number four?
Five.
Five. Well, racing ahead. Or catching up, at least. So, arrow-marked babblers are a social species. They live in little flocks where they can babble to each other. Now, the reason they're called arrow-marked, there we go, is Dave uses the super zoom. You see, a little white, I mean, he's a bit fluffed this morning. Those little white marks on their chest look like little arrows pointing upwards. Oh, off it goes. Now, a very, very warm welcome to a warm part of the world. Hello, Aaron in Florida. Aaron is wondering, are the more colorful birds males, and are all males colorful? Well, Aaron, no, it all depends on the species. And most very colorful males, it's to do with attracting the ladies. So different males have different strategies, whether it be being colorful, being loud, being very displayful, and we have a really wonderful variation of all in this part of the world, from certain species that only develop their color during the breeding season and then become drab and brown during the non-breeding season. And then we have species like the arrow-marked babbler we just saw, where everyone's sort of the same. And it's more about who can be the noisiest and the most impressive when it comes to talking. That wins the ladies. So I suppose if we had to compare... Oh, look at that. It's so weird. I thought I'd turn my lights on. Just look at this beautiful light that suddenly just crept through. There's a tiny gap in the clouds that the sun has managed to creep through. It's going to disappear. We're going to go dark again. There we go. Look at that. It's just the tiniest of tiny gaps that the sun crept through for a second there and brought us the most wonderful soft yellow light. Okay, here we go, it's gone. It was literally 5 seconds of beautiful yellow light. Okay, so now as I said, I'm very convinced the Nkuhuma pride are here. Now I'm just double checking now. So I only had tracks of at least 3 lionesses, but they were what one would call running tracks, or let's rephrase, galloping tracks, and they were galloping after buffalo. The amount of vultures that are here make me think that they are definitely here, and they've definitely made a kill. Now it's quite a big area with no roads, so it might take us a little longer than I'd like to find these lions, but find them we shall. I've called Rex in, and Rex is going to go have a nice long walk here. Of course, I don't want to leave you guys for too long, so that's why I keep my walks relatively short. Oh. And what do we have up there? We have another bird, number 6. Just 1 second, sorry, I gotta be on the radio. Taylor, channel 5 on our radios. Here we go, a grey go-away bird. And for once, they're being quiet, which is quite pleasant. Now, I know you've already seen it with Taylor, but you haven't seen it with me and Dave. And, of course, as I said, every time I stop, I'm listening. I'm hoping for the growl of lions on a kill. The distant peck of a woodpecker is all we're hearing at the moment. Okay. So it's, where are you lions? Now, while we meander through, I think... Actually, I've got a question for all of our regular birders, our twitchers out there. Why don't you guys let me know what is the most rare bird you've ever seen on a live safari? I'm thinking the 2 most rare birds that I've ever put on camera was the pale morph booted eagle and the purple banded sunbird. But let me know what is the most rare bird you have ever seen on a live safari. And remember, questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag safari live on Twitter. Let me know. And I'm trying to think, what else have we've seen, but I think for me those are the two apart from the one white-throated robin. Now the white-throated robin is very localized, quite rare in this area, but very localized, but we hear them more than we see them. But we're going to keep looking for these lions, and I think how many birds are on, Dave? 6 7 6. Okay, so 6. Let's go see if Taylor's got any more to show you.
Good morning again. I have had no luck though. I've just seen a whole lot of little birds just fly into here, but they seem very buddy. It's another bird party. We've got a bushbuck as well running away. Oh, a crested barbet. Can you see the crested barbet up on that tree? Ah, yes. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. How awesome is that? So I don't know how many birds I'm on because I've got so many. I'm so proud to say that. And there's a few little tawny flank prinias again zitting around. But that barbet is really beautiful. It's hiding away. It's jumping up and around the trees, which is making it very, very difficult. Oh, look at that. Sneaky, having breakfast, making me hungry. So we are apparently on 10 birds, and that is just not good enough. We need to keep this count going higher. I think I've just seen a robin. I'm going to go forward a little bit, just because there's something hopping around. Maybe it's a, I don't know, brown scrub robin or white-browed scrub robin. I'm not sure. Let's have a look. Where did you go? Where did you go? I'm just trying to have a little look-see. Although we've got a Natal Spurfowl running away from us, but I don't think we're going to catch that on camera. I don't know, Brian, if you saw that racing off into the distance. I think he's gone. Why is everybody... I think we got to go... Where are you? There you are! Okay, 11. It's gone behind some very thick stuff, but I don't know if you saw, there was a brown thing that was moving around very, very quickly. And I think, I just want to see, I saw this little robin that I saw hopping around. I can hear one calling too, but I don't know which one it is. You know what? I've never seen a white-throated robin before. I'm going to very quickly play the call so I can familiarize myself. You're all welcome to listen while I find the call of this robin. Give me a 2 seconds. White-throated robin. That's none of you. Are you here? No? White-browed? Oh, yeah. Hello. That's very pretty. Let's see if we can play. I need to remember that. Can you all hear that? Very interesting call, but we've got someone else calling. I think we've got a white browed. I don't know, the birds are all chirping in here, but unfortunately they're not showing us themselves, which is a problem because we need to see the birds to actually be able to count them on our list. Brent's got something that eats other birds and other animals. Let's hope he doesn't get too far ahead.
There's a tawny eagle. Now, I'm always very interested when I see a tawny eagle. Now, like the battalier, they're quite often the first to arrive at a carcass and often lead the other birds of prey. Oh. Yes, it is a tawny. I second-guessed myself there for a second. It's quite a bit bigger than a Wahlberg's. And we're coming up to an area where there's a lot of vultures as well. So far, only white-backed vultures I can see. They're up ahead of us here, spread through all the trees. Thanks very much, Joey, looking at vultures. Joey says the rarest bird he's seen on drive is a Cape vulture. Well, maybe we'll be lucky enough to see another one today. Looking at, there is a possible Cape vulture there. Okay, so there is a Cape vulture. Wow, Joey, you seem to be psychic. So behind, there we go, yawning right now. Can see how much bigger it is than the white-backed vultures. You can see it's physically a lot bigger. White-back vulture is a massive bird. Cape vulture is even bigger. So in the center of the screen, there's a vulture. Right behind it, you can just see his head coming out to the right. And you can see it's lighter colored. That is a Cape vulture. Well, thanks, Joey. I was about to discard the vultures, thinking they were all white-backed. And the lions have to be here somewhere. But just while we're doing birds, Dave, on the ground opposite me. That's just... there we go. A red-billed buffalo weaver. Oh! Off it flew. Maybe some more around. Oh no, they've all flown. Anyway, it counts. And we're going to move a little bit further forward here.
Let's try and get a nice view of that Cape vulture. Apparently on 9 birds now, so one behind Taylor, I think. Oh, two behind Taylor. Yes, but sometimes it's better to have quality rather than quantity. And talking about quality before they fly away, now you can see the size difference. There we go. In that, oh, there we go. That's what the Cape vulture thinks of us. So you can see the size difference between the Cape and white-back vultures there. And you can see the pale coloration. Now, it's white-back vultures have quite a lot of different coloration from dark. And even the one just to the left of the Cape vulture, even though it is light-colored, you can see the size difference. Now, the interesting thing about Cape vultures, now this vulture has probably come from over 100 kilometers away. Now, white, there we go, look at fluff, 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 Cape vulture fluffing. Now, white-backed vultures will nest in this part of the world almost exclusively in acacia trees and almost 80% in acacia nigrescens or the knobthorn trees. A Cape vulture only nests on cliffs. And they will travel hundreds of kilometers a day to find food. Sorry, guys, just need to be on the radio for a second. Oh, I do like vultures, though. Okay, so while I sort out the radio, let's go to Taylor, who's sneaking even further ahead with a Hallison bird.
We have a little brown hooded kingfisher, which is fantastic. That's really nice to add to the list. So he's just perched over there. We actually had a very nice view of this bird a few seconds ago, but unfortunately it didn't like us and it flew away onto a further dead tree, and now we're viewing him through some sticks and leaves and all sorts of things. I've actually just spotted a squirrel. Can you see him? Just, he's actually looking straight at us, grooming us on this tree that bends quite nicely. This one that's straight to our left, you see where the termite mound is directly, yeah, below it, the chimney. Follow that tree up and the branch that's furthest to the left. So we've got a little squirrel. He's cleaning himself. So I just want to, we just want to have a quick look at the squirrel because it's actually quite nice. Can you see him? Oh, hello. So we are on 12 birds now, and now we are going to watch this lovely little tree squirrel clean itself. Mmm, yum. Parasites. Delicious. What are you doing? I think everybody's a bit sad today. It's sort of movie weather out in the bush, and I think they were hoping there was going to be a bit of sand to warm up and have lots of energy. But everyone's a bit miserable, and this squirrel is very itchy, very, very itchy. You need some anti-dandruff shampoo or something. What are you doing? Mmm. Michelle from New Jersey, good morning, as we watch the squirrel. Michelle was asking about, oh, we have another bird. Hang on, Michelle, I'm going to get back to your question now. We have a crested Franklin. We are on 12 birds, everybody, 12 birds and counting. I think we're just going to sit here and wait for them to come to us. This one is coming right towards us. Don't worry, Michelle, I haven't forgotten about you. I'm going to answer your question now. So while we keep watching little Frankie the Franklin over here, munch away. So Michelle was asking, do any animals shed their coats during the winter months, sort of coming seasonal, I suppose? And yes, to the extent that they just sort of become a slightly fluffier. So like your dogs at home, let's talk about something that you're all quite familiar with. You know that when you groom them and brush them, coming out of winter, you know how much hair you have. So it's pretty much the same thing with the animals. They just get sort of talking about the antelope, of course, there, and I'm pretty sure the squirrels will just fluff up a little bit and then they will lose that and get a summer coat. There's actually two little Franklins, but the other one is behind some trees. And this one is going behind a tree too. So this is actually proving very promising, this little stretch of road that we've got here. We're doing a little boat cruise this morning. An imaginary boat cruise on the SS Brian. We'll name it after Brian. This morning, let's carry on going. And we're just going to see if we can quickly pick up on a few more birds. I have seen a few little things fluttering around in the distance. So I think we're going to float on forward and see if we can get some more. I can hear another brown-hooded kingfisher calling in the distance. Wee. But Miss Lynn, fantastic. I'm so glad we can provide your cat with entertainment this morning. That's an unusual viewer. So you're going to have to try and get a photo of your cat watching the screen. That would be quite interesting, wouldn't it? And post it on Twitter for us. So Miss Lynn said that her cat is enjoying the show because it is watching. And obviously, cats like birds. Most task cats aren't always the greatest hunters, though. I think some of them have lost that sort of instinct. Some are better than others. But that's quite nice. Oh, I can hear a few little tweety tweets and things, but I can't see anything just yet. So I'm just looking up to the tops of the trees just to make sure that we're not missing anything. We're getting to a point where I think there could possibly be another bird party. There's a lot of action going on here. It's very noisy. Little bee eater, got it. And so we have a little bee eater over here who is fluttering away. So what are we gonna do? Let's see if we can reposition. How you going there, Brian? No. Okay. So we need to just quickly sort out a little issue over here. Sorry, everybody. We will be back with you shortly, though. And we're going to carry on looking for some birds. Hopefully we're going to get this little bee eater. That's going to be our plan. Radio. Let's carry on driving a little bit further, though.
Multitasking. Not only are we looking for birds, we're looking for lions. So Rexon has the same set of tracks that I had a little bit earlier. They are heading north, so he's checking on foot. And we're going to zoop around and check on the northern boundary. Fingers crossed they haven't disappeared to the north. But while we are checking for lions, I'm sure we might be able to add a bird species or five. Okay, so we need to go slowly because we need to check for tracks. Just listening to the radio here quickly. So apparently there's two male lions and three females on the Kruger Park boundary. So I wonder if that's not the Torchwood Pride and not the Nkuhuma. So I'm going to ask to see if there's any sign of any of those females lactating, because that's how we'll know. Well, James and Carl say that the greater honey guide was the rarest. Now, strangely enough, that is not actually a rare bird in this part of the world. But I have to agree with you. I've seen it once and heard it a second time. So maybe it's just where we are that we're not seeing the greater honey guide. So I'm just waiting for a chance to ask whether any of those... lioness are lactating. Station with those in Ngala on Kruger Boundary, are any of those females lactating? Wait to hear. Copy, thanks, Fermin. So if none of them are lactating, is it possibly not Torchwood Pride? We've got tracks of females chasing buffalo around Buffalo's Dam. I'm just trying to
ascertain whether we are searching for a lost cause. Okay, so it looks like it's Torchwood Pride. None of the females are lactating. So that means, hopefully the Nkuhumas are sitting happy and pretty on a buffalo in here. Now, of course, as we try find buffalo, birds. So Alice, Joan and Jen would like to know if there are any updates on the dead buffalo in Arethusa. I'm not sure. I think Taylor's heading in that direction. I'm focusing on these tracks that we've got here in inside Juma. But what I'll do is I'll jump on the radio just now, get hold of the guys in the west and see if there is any updates. Dave, why aren't you spotting birds? I'm looking for tracks. Well, there we go. Raisa has spotted, not spotted, Dave has spotted something. Raisa said they saw a greater painted snipe once. Oh, well done, Dave. Magpie shrike. I'm taking this opportunity to listen again. Now, magpie shrikes live in flocks, and if we have a look, there's quite a few more of them off to the left. We can hear it calling. There we go. That's the one that's calling. Oh, another one flying in. Now, they will defend their home range very aggressively against other magpie shrikes. I've actually seen magpie shrikes kill each other before. Oh, on the ground. Just to the... there. Somewhere. There we go. No. That's the babbler. There was a hornbill there. Where did he go? Oh, there he is. Okay, a little bit more to the left, a little bit more to the right, zoom, oh, he's gone behind the tree, there we go, there he is, red bull, hornbill, now, it seems like Taylor is really putting up a challenge this morning, so she's got probably my favorite merops species that we get on in the Sabi Sands. So let's go have a look.
Brett, that's so good to know that this is your favorite little bee eater. So as I just said, this is a little bee eater, the smallest of the species of bee eaters in southern Africa. And there were a few others zooting around with it. However, it seems to be now be on its own, and it's been very, very patient with us. We've been following it now for the last few minutes, and there it goes. It dropped down to the perch below. It's gone down to the left. We'll catch it again. And they're such wonderful little creatures. I really love it when they do all sit on a stick in a row like that, when you have five or six of them all cuddled up next to each other. It makes for a very, very pretty picture. And if only the rest would come and join, I could maybe win the photo competition with a picture like that. So something quite interesting about these birds is, obviously, as their name suggests, bee eaters, they are specialists in eating insects with stings. So not just limited to bees, but also wasps and all sorts of other goodies. And you'll often see they'll swoop down doing all sorts of acrobatics in the sky, and they'll snap up what they want, and then they'll fly back down to the perch, and then you'll see them doing a strange thing of rubbing their beaks on a stick or whatever they may be perched on, and that's to actually remove the little stinger, and then they eat it. I mean, how clever is that? Very, very clever. And they just remove the stinger, which is nice, so they don't get rid of too much of the flesh either, so they still have quite a good meal. Look at that, amazing. Nice perch back. a little bit closer. It's actually a lovely little bird. So I think we're on 12 birds now, if I'm not mistaken. And there was also an orange-breasted bushrike again calling for us, which was really nice. We're going to now, I think, go on a little bit. Oh, we're on 13. I'm not giving myself enough credit, but Brent's not far behind. He's on 11. I think we're going to have to go further forward. We're going to go under this little tunnel of love over here and see what else we can find. I saw something else flying, but it may have been that bee eater again, because I have to take my eye off of it. There's quite a few of them fluttering around here this morning. Okay, let's go through here. Watch your heads. And we've got Brian moving the aerial. Thank you, Brian. Ah, now I'm jealous. I had Brent's favorite bird. Brent's got my favorite mammal. I'll see you back a little later.
Look at this. I mean, they were right next to us. I'm just going to roll back a little bit. Lovely female elephant and her offspring. Actually, a breeding herd all around us. Hi, Ellie's. What are you up to? It's a little female. Just roll back a little bit. Oh, it's going to charge. It's and charge the tree. Yes, the tree is very scared of you. Oh no, it's going to play with the other one. Which she's caused absolute panic. She was playing, and now she's just literally. Everyone thinks something's everyone's ears are up. They don't know what's going on. Mom, of course, is just looking at this going, what are you doing, child? Look at Mom. Mom is so relaxed. Probably like a lot of mothers feel quite often. Now she's like, oh no, dear, the baby's run so far away, I need to catch up. Hello, Mom. Sorry, we didn't do anything. Yes. It was your child. Well, off she goes. We're going to keep moving because I have a secret. Oh, I have a secret. Dave? Do we have a secret?
Yes, we do.
We have a secret. The secret requires us to move. Oh, but before we do, just to stay in touch with Taylor and the birds, I saw a bird. Where did it go now? Oh, dear. Where's it gone? There was a crested Franklin. Where did they go? Yeah, we're going to do, we'll count to five. One, two, three, four, five. Alas, Taylor is about to creep further ahead, but I've still got a secret.
You see there? Quickly, 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 look what we've got. We had it perched so beautifully, and now we have. A bit hard, like I said, with the grey sky. That was an African hoopoe that we very quickly got a glimpse of, but we saw it. And was that a? We've got the Cape Glossy Starling, which we didn't have. We missed earlier, so we can add that one now too. So that should be on 15 birds for us. It's a pity that hoopoe didn't hang around for very long. But however, out of all the different starlings that we get, I absolutely love the Cape Glossy. I love the noises that they make. They're hysterical, and just their whole behavior around them is very comical, especially when they come down and bathe in a pond of water. That's always fun to watch. So fantastic, we're on 15, and I've got a beautiful Inyala bull for you, just up straight ahead, feeding on the banks of the Mwati. The river is raging this morning. You can see it's very bumpy in here. I've had been a little bit seasick already. Oh, Okay, excuse us. Just race away from me then. It's very rude of that Nyala. Oh, terribly behaved. Now we've got a bump. Here we go. We did have an opportunity, but he's moving too quickly for us to get a screenshot of his bum. But now he's moved out of the way. But I have no doubt that we will most likely see some more Nyala along the banks of the very dry Mowati River, unfortunately. Hopefully we'll get that white-throated robin. I believe that this is the place to go if you are looking for a white-throated robin. So let's carry on. I'm just coming undone a little bit here. I'll make sure I get connected. All right, let's go. Oh. Ha ha ha. Genevieve says for the calendar. It's so clever. Why didn't I think of it? So she's for the calendar. Remember I said to you how I'd love it if you could give me some suggestions for names. And she said, what if we call it? But this is Safari Live. I think that's wonderful, Genevieve. I quite like that. If anybody thinks they can top Genevieve's name for the calendar, please send them in. You can either hashtag Safari Live, or you can send an email to questions@wildearth.tv. So you can contact us in many ways. If you want to do a smoke signal too, that's fine. Or pigeon with a little note on its foot, we can do that. But just creep through here, just because this is quite a little canopy. Maybe we see something. Oh, what was just darting away from us? Can hear a few little birds, but I can't see anything just yet. Oh, let's see what we have here. I don't know, does anybody know any bird enticing songs? Because I don't. But if anybody does, please send through the lyrics so I can learn it and sing it. Not that my voice is very good at singing, I apologize. Yeah, my name may be Taylor, but I'm nothing like Swift. And I know Brent was going to try and use that. Maybe he has used that already. I'm not sure. Right, nothing behind us, nothing in the tops of the trees. How disappointing. Aha! I stole it. So now Brent can't use the Taylor Swift thing. So James Richard would like to know what my most interesting experience has been with a bird. So, have any of you ever heard of a greater honey guide? Actually, I might just quickly stop and get a little photo for you. Oh, okay, never mind. I don't need to, because I think Brent was chatting about the Greater Honey Guide earlier, and I hope he hasn't told the same story I've just told you. But my personal most exciting experience has to be when I was in the Lower Zambezi National Park, and we heard this call coming from this bird, and we identified it as a Greater Honey Guide, and we tried to follow it. So there's an old folklore that they say that the honey guides will actually lead you to a beehive, and they're unable to, unfortunately, get the wax, the comb, and they'll eat the larvae, they'll eat a variety of different things. And obviously it's a great little treat for us as humans to have honey. So there's an old folklore where they say if you follow it, eventually it will take you to this beehive. And now the trick is that you have to give a piece of the comb to the bird. If you don't, the next time you follow one, it's going to lead you to a snake. And I've heard a few gentlemen who have been working in the bush for a long time, some of the local people around the area, who have said that, you know, they have been led to snakes a few times. I, however, haven't. This bird we followed for, I think, about 3.5 hours, and I thought I was going to end up in Mozambique. So I do not follow honey guides anymore, because they don't seem to take me anywhere. They just take me on a walkabout. You can just hear something chatting away. No, it sounds like a starling. Never mind. We'll carry on. Brent wants to talk to me. Brent Taylor. He must be missing me. Brent, I'm standing by for you. We've got some go-away birds in a jackalberry tree. Let's see. Actually, let's stop and have a look at this jackalberry and just see what we've got happening in here. Go, Brent. Whee! See if we've got anything in here. Cubby, thank you. Fantastic. Oh, just had a little catch up with Brent. We've just got a few starlings, I think, that are flying around. There's a go-away bird too that we're looking at now. And these are wonderful trees. And I can't see too much fruit though. It's like the birds have already got here and eaten most of it. But I can hear a lot more, but they do just sound like starlings. I was hoping we were going to get to some of these big jackalberries and they were just going to be absolutely filled with bird life. But at the moment, it doesn't seem that way. I think we're going to make our way out of the Muwati. We're going to go and give a few of the other rangers a helping hand and try and follow up on some lion tracks. So we're going to actually do a big loop. We're going to go back around and we're going to go all the way north again. So I need to try and work out how to get onto Hyena Road. But I saw the thumb this morning with a map. Maybe he'll be able to help me. Rightio, let's see. Let's think we're going to have to go out here. Right. Let's go up this way. I presume we've got to go north-ish again. Carry on. Oh, I hope you enjoyed that mum and calf elephant. I would have loved to have seen her this morning. Like I said, everybody knows they're my absolute favorite animal. Sorry, I've lost something. What am I? Oh no, it's in my pocket. I'm losing my mind this morning. That's the only thing I've lost. Okay, radio. Hyena Road, Hyena Road. Let me actually get hold of Aubrey for a second. Aubrey Taylor. Lots of go-away birds. Whee! Through a little roller coaster. Not really. This is a small one. Okay, up we go. Nothing happening here. Sorry, I didn't quite get the name there. Is it Genevieve, if I heard correctly? Blair, oh my goodness, how hard am I of hearing? Brian, should we go this way? Let's go this way. So, Blair, I'm so sorry, I don't know. You want to know when the Woodlands Kingfisher is coming back. That should be soon. What month are we in now? In September. We actually should start seeing them late September, early October. Last year they came back quite early. I saw my first one. This is down in the southern sands though, so it could vary slightly. But I saw my one, I think, in the last week of September. So always going to be listening out for that call. That's when you really know when summer is here. When that weather is really heating up, they tend to come back again. So they're beautiful birds. I'd actually like to try and also see a striped kingfisher. I haven't seen one for a while. They've got a stunning call as well. So this is a very good area to have a look. Ah, you've been seeing quite a few striped kingfishers with Brent. That's lovely. That's nice, you know. Even though there's not a lot of water around, you'd actually think it's quite unusual to be seeing kingfishers. However, these particular ones that we have been talking about are predominantly feeding on insects, which is nice. We're snatching up all those things that fly into our faces and that we don't like very much. When you can't always burn elephant dung, so the birds have got to do their part too. I'm going to just try and get hold of the rangers again. Aubrey Taylor. Which mobiles are following up on the Mafazin Gwanyama, Mantuan and Kunza around Hyena Road? Copy, can I come and join you? And so can you just identify yourself? Hubby, thanks. So, I'm just gonna check. Ah, okay, Brent's just helping me a little bit. Because I don't know the property very well. Let me just say thank you very much. Copy, thanks. So, Mr. Thumb, we need your navigation assistance. We need to go and check concrete crossing near Vuyotela Dam. So, that's where we're going to be heading. Oh, a little commandeer. Are you going to stand by for us? No, you're not. Let's see if we can maybe get a little shot. Do you think he's going to stay? Let's go forward just a little bit. Just have a little look at this little common daker. It's just up top there. There we go. Maybe we're going to get a very quick glimpse of it. Are you going to come out or are you going to just disappear over the back? Oh, no. Hello. There you are. Don't often get to capture these chaps on camera. Well, very nice. So that's really nice. It looks like a male. The horns are blending in so well with the sticks, and off it goes. That's usually what we get, but at least we got to very quickly have a look at a common daker. We're going to still carry on making our way towards this area with the post to go. If I can get go into reverse. Right. Clear my throat there. All right, don't panic, everybody. I'm not getting ready to sing or anything. Hello, Jean from Los Angeles. So Jean says, thinks we should call it the Tale of Juma for the Bums of Africa calendar. That's quite nice. I quite like that. That'll be another container. We've got some more barbets. Actually, just because they're so pretty, I don't know, can you see them in there? And we had a good view. There's another one jumping up a bit further to the right. Look at these two. There's a pair of them here. And I know we have seen them already. And I do actually enjoy the birds and watching them. These guys are not just sitting around for us. They keep moving away, which is unfortunate. I wish they would just sit still. And now we've got the sun, which is also proving to be a little bit difficult. They're playing hide and seek. Where's Wally? Where's Barbie? I don't know what we can call the bird game. We're going this way. Okay. Goodbye, Barbets. Ah, that's a lovely bird. Joey wants me to find a black-collared Barbet. And you're all the way from Australia. That's a long way home. For those of you that don't actually know, most of my family lives in Australia, in Melbourne. So I say strange words every now and then, and I blame my parents for that because they taught me that Australian language is just slightly different from English. Okay, we can always try and look for a black-collared barbet. The best way to find them is actually just to hear their call and then just to take it from there. I haven't heard any calling recently. Actually, I haven't heard any calling since I've been here. But we'll keep an eye out. Oh my goodness, it's daker heaven today. They're bouncing about everywhere. I don't know if we're gonna see what that one. That one is racing away from us. Oh, I'm just hearing little snippets on the radio. I just wanna find out. Aubrey Taylor. Maybe they've got some alliance for us. Aubrey, did you locate those in Gwanyam? Copy. I'm gonna go check around the concrete crossing. Right. So these lions have been racing around all morning. Can you believe it? In and out, in and out. It's like they do it on purpose and try to hide away. But luckily we've got Rexon, who you are all familiar with. He helps with the walking. And he's actually trying to track them on foot, so that is going to be great if he can get them for us. But we're just still going to just check around the outside. Remember the other morning, I think it was two mornings ago, when the whole pride of the Nkuhumas actually crossed out and we were just a few steps behind them. which was very unfortunate. So I'm a firm believer in checking roads over and over again just to make double sure. Like we had them crossing over Brent's tire, very fresh tire tracks, and then crossing out of our traverse. So let's hope that's not the case today. We're slowly going to start moving into the area. I'm going to pick up the pace slightly. I think we're a little bit behind. And we're still looking for birds, of course, along the way. Radio, nothing. Not looking for all the spider webs that are going to start to come back. I think, oh, I've got a big aerial, a spider web catcher. So RT says that Wild Earth has actually turned him into a birder, which is fantastic. You know, I wasn't fond of birds when I first started guiding. I thought they were quite boring, and actually I have to blame my dad for that, but I'll go into that in a little bit later. I'll tell you about the story about my dad and hating birds. Brent has got something else for you, a feathery creature.
Okay, we've got bad signal, but it's worth it. You got them, there we go. Not a bird we see too often, Rhett's helmet shrikes. Used to be called red-billed helmet shrikes. A lovely little flock of them. Definitely worth risking the signal to see. About 7 or 8 of them in that flock. So, cousin to the white helmeted helmet shrike that we see very often. Are they there? Oh, well, he flew. Yeah. There's one. Unfortunately, the light's quite difficult, so we're not really getting a good visual, but it is a bird we don't see often. That's why we stopped, even in this bad signal area. The Rhett's helmet shrike. Oh, off they fly. And Dave, go there, just so we get it there. Where my finger is, there we go. Natal Franklin. Now, I wonder what the score is. I think we're a bit behind, Dave.
Yeah.
But we like a challenge, don't we, Dave?
Yes, we do.
Oh, we're only two behind. And I've got a secret. I wonder if everyone forgot that we had a secret. So we're going to head back to Taylor, just because if I move, we might lose signal here. But I really wanted to show you those Rhett's helmet shrikes. So as we move on, oh wait, they might be able to get a better view of them now in that tree there. See, there we go. Okay, there we go. You can see the red bill and the red eye of the Rhett's helmet shrike. It was a bit more difficult when they were up against the white sky. Off it goes. So as off it goes, we'll go off back to Taylor while we go to the big secret.
Did you manage to, I hope you managed to have a little squiz at what Brent was trying to show you. We are still trying to navigate through Juma Private Game Reserve. For those of you who have, if that name sounds foreign, it's in the Sabi Sands, which is a private wilderness area, I suppose you could call it. It's probably one of the best game viewing in South Africa, or it is the best game viewing in South Africa, and that is situated in South Africa. And we are live right now, and we are trying to find lions, but I see we've got a beautiful male waterbuck. So I'm just gonna sneak off the road just a little, just in case somebody wants to come past. There we go, just pull our bombs off. Let's have a look at this little waterbuck. Well, he's not actually little. That's very rude of me. He is a fairly young male though, but he's got a lovely splay of horns. And I keep forgetting, oh, actually, before I getting so sidetracked here, we're going to have a bum opportunity, everybody. Get ready to take those screenshots. I might have to quickly whip out my camera. And I'm not prepared, so none of my settings will be right. So let's quickly see. But that is a perfect bum photo. You know what? It would be even better if he would actually look over his shoulder towards us and give us a nice smile. I've never seen waterbuck smile before. Oh, no, sometimes when they phlegm and grimace, you can see them smiling. But that's a nice bum photo. What do you think? So I look forward to looking at them a little bit later. So remember to hashtag Safari Live, or you can even, I suppose you could actually even send them in your screenshots to questions@wildearth.tv if you'd like to. So he's on his own. He's probably been sent off by his herd. Actually, I'm going to take us away from the water back because I've seen you, yellow-billed hornbill. I've seen you in the elephant dung, and we haven't got you yet, and we are actually still doing a birding competition. Hello, munching away. Most likely found some termites or something, and they're living underneath the dung. So I'm sure you heard yesterday I was helping James out in the tent. You can actually see the termites going up, and it was something I was doing. I was actually kicking over a lot of dung to see if I could find any critters that were living underneath it. Yes, I did. I destroyed their homes a little bit, but then I put the roof back on, and I knew that they would just repair it, so I didn't feel too bad. But lucky for this hornbill that the weather is warming up a little bit after yesterday's cold spell, so I think the insects will be moving around a little bit, because when I was looking I barely found any termites when I was kicking over the dung. Elephant dung is quite nice. Termites are so important as well, so I hope he doesn't eat too many, not only as a food source for various species of animals, but they are also the number one decomposers of organic matter in the world. So yes, I know in the States and other places in the world they can be quite a problem because they eat the wood in the houses. Luckily for us in South Africa, we don't have too many wood-eating termites. Most of them prefer either leaf litter or grasses, or obviously just decomposing dung for us. They're vitally important to the ecosystem. If they go extinct, so will quite a few different mammal and bird species, and I suppose some other insects and reptiles that feed on them. And I reckon that that ecosystem would collapse. I think they are that important. So let's keep the termites alive. Munching away. I love the way that they pick something up and then they throw it and tilt their head back and munch. Mmm, delicious. Beautiful eye. This actually looks like a male. Got quite a robust beak. Females tend to have a slightly more slender beak. My goodness, having a termite feast. Yum, yum, yum. So I think that's we're on 16 now, if I'm not mistaken. 16 birds, which is not bad. Maybe I should get a... Yay, I'm doing well. I managed to cut. Let's get a photo of the hornbill. Take your screenshots because I keep forgetting we're doing a competition today and I actually haven't been taking any photos. So I just want to get one good one. Hey, no. No, I didn't mean to scare you, Birdie. I want to get you with your mouth open and a termite. Try it again. I'm waiting. We're all waiting on you. Hello. Okay, he's not cooperating. Not cooperating. And we are on the waterback. Oh, we've got another one now. We've got two waterback. We can technically call this a herd. Hello, Mary Ellen. Mary Ellen wants to know what my favorite antelope is, and my favorite antelope has to be an inyala. I really enjoy the inyala. They're lovely creatures, their coloration, just everything about them is really beautiful. So, yeah, I like the way that they wear little shoes. I like the stripes and the spots that they have on their markings, and I suppose the males are the real pretty ones. I'll go forward a little bit just so we can get a better view of the waterbuck. Because they're quite interesting and you can always improve your bum snap. Maybe we even get a little whiff of them as we go past. Erdele waterbuck. I don't know if I'd purchase it from a shop though. They don't smell very nice. That's basically what I'm saying. Hello. Oh, we've got a female as well. Find her. Ah, hello girl. There we go, another bum opportunity. So Michael says we should call this calendar the Bush Bums Safari Live collection. I think, yes. And that's what he says. That's also a good one. I'm going to have to write all of these down and then pick my favorite. So I think I'll do that in the morning, after drive this morning. I'll go back and write down a few of the names, but I'll keep it going for a few more days, and or maybe another week or so, and then maybe I'll choose the best name, and then from there we'll take it further. You can hear the hornbills chatting away now in the distance. Let's carry on. We're supposed to be moving into the area of where these lions could potentially be, but we keep getting sidetracked. I'm known for that, though. I have butterfly syndrome. Anything shiny or anything that moves will grab my attention, and I forget what I'm supposed to be doing. It's not always a good thing, but I don't think it's always a bad thing. So yes, sometimes I have the attention span of a goldfish. So I think we're going straight. Well, we're gonna head to Brent now. He's moved on to Cheetah Plains, and hopefully he's got something exciting for you.
Welcome to Cheetah Plains, a private game reserve. This is in the far east of our traverse. It borders the Kruger National Park. So, very exciting. We have a secret. Dave, I've forgotten what the secret was. Do you remember what the secret was? I think we're birding today. Yes, we're birding. So, it's a secret bird. That's what it is. Now, there's your hint to what we could be rushing to. It's a bird, a secret bird. Now, some of our long-time viewers might have caught that hint. We will see, we will see. So let me know what you think our secret is. And if you know, tweet it, hashtag Safari Live, or email it, questions@wildearth.tv. But we are birding. This is not the secret bird, but it is a bird. We can't let Taylor get too far ahead. Oh no, it's flying over. Where's he going? Where's he going? Don't fly too far. He's flown too far. Oh, there's another one. Over it goes. See if we can see where it lands. Land on top of that marula. Good bird. Oh, there we go. Southern black tit. Can hear it calling, zeet, zeet. There's a pair of them. So apparently Taylor's on 16, we're on 14. Dave, when should we start birding properly? Because we've sort of been dallying about. Oh. But we do have a secret bird. Oh, it's my good old friend. I haven't seen him in quite a while. And he's a bit far from his normal traversing area, but this definitely falls part of his territory. And it is, of course, Gnomon the Gnu. So you can see that there's a bit more grass here. It's a seep line. So it's nice and open, a couple of terminalia trees. And a Gnomon. Oh, Reedbuk! Two Reedbuk! Oh, there's a male and female Reedbuk. There's the female. Where'd the male go? He ran ahead of the female. I'll move now. Standing by Andrew. Where'd the male go? There he is. Okay. So there's two Reedbuk, a male and a female. Copy, thanks Andrew. I'm not there yet. I'm still on my way. But I should be there in the next 10. Look at that! that Reedbuk? Isn't that exciting? It's so exciting, I feel I need the need to call it on the radio. Copy, thanks. Andrew, there's also Mzigi close to that Cheetah Plains Mighty. So exciting, Reedbuk. Reedbuk. So exciting, a male and female Reedbuk. This is the first time I've ever seen two. I've only seen one female before. One more look. You see them, Dave. One more look. This is the amazing thing about being out on a live drive. You never know. Wait, let me just go back. Let's see if we can get a clear view of the male. So they've got beautiful curved horns. You see them there, Dave? All right, forward, back. There we go. Look at that. You can see his horns there through the bush. A male Reedbuk. So fluffy. It's even more fluffy because we never see them, of course. But anyway, we're still on our way to the secret bird. Thanks, Gnorman, my good old friend, the Gnu, for leading us towards the Reedbuk. Let's carry on. Ha 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 ha. So I said I'm on my way to a secret bird, but it's a bit more cryptic than that, Stephanie. Stephanie thinks it might be an ostrich. We always have a chance of seeing ostrich down here, but it's a cryptic bird. So much fun to keep you in the dark. It is. I'm quite happy this morning because that cloud is breaking up. We're going to have some beautiful sunshine soon. Sally, hi Sally, who's in sunny Southern California, is it a secret hairy bird? Oh, I don't know, Sally. Are birds hairy? Ah, a secretary bird. It could be, it could not be. But I think we need to think a bit more. It is a very cryptic bird. Ah, and I think I'm almost giving it away too much. And we're nearly there. It is on the open plains. Oh, Gnorman, what are you doing over there? There are ladies over here. Gnorman's obviously missing a beat today. Dave, as the ladies' man in camp, you're going to have a word with Gnorman. There we go. Gnorman's missing out. There's some females on his open area, although he's munching away on the seep line where there's a bit of grass. Gnorman's missing the ladies. Well, you snooze, you lose, Norman. Gnorman, you gotta watch out. Maybe normal Norman will take your spot. It will lure the ladies onto his open area. We've also got some zebras. Let's get a little bit closer. Hello, zebras. Looks like they're on their way towards the Cheetah Plains Pan. A nice little harem of zebra. Of course, I'm not being rude. That is the correct term for a group of zebra. A harem, a stallion with a group of females. Very, very interesting stripes. Now, each individual zebra, like a leopard's spots or your fingerprint, has its unique stripes. And off they march towards the water, and we're going to march towards our secret bird. And poor Gnorman, missing out on the ladies. They're going to pass all the way to normal Norman's territory, before poor Gnorman even knows they're here. Same place. Nkuhuma. Okay, so the secret bird is still there. Now, what bird could draw other game drive vehicles, not just us? Mm-hmm. But while we're on our way to the secret bird, I think I feel the need to catch up with Tayla. So let's have a look on the open plains. We might get a pipit. We might get a lapwing or two. Of course, as soon as I look for a lapwing, when we come here, there's normally lapwings on every spot. Now today, of course, there's no lapwings. There, I think. With a yellow-billed hornbill, a common one, come out of it. And to the, out a bit more, to the right, I think. There we go, zoom center frame. Up a little bit. A little bit to the right. Ah, there we go. Yellow-billed hornbill. Marianne says a yellow-breasted palus. Now, Marianne, that is a bird that is rarely seen on camera, but not a rare bird. So it is not the yellow-breasted palus. I can tell you for a fact, the rare bird we're about to appear at, it will only be the second time I've ever seen this bird. And that's in all my time at Safari Live. So I think we're one behind Tayla now. I think we're 15. We could even be equal. On the ground. Okay, a little bit to the right. Zoom. Aha, ring-necked doves. Now, if we go out to the left, but very slowly, very slowly. Okay, there we go. Zoom. A little bit. There we go. Grey-headed sparrow. I think we might have taken the lead, Dave. Oh, yeah. I hope we have. Now, just to the right of that grey-headed sparrow. There we go, zoom, out to the right, up, up, there we go, aha, and we have a little pipit, an African pipit. Now we definitely have taken the lead with that, but while we make our way to the secret bird, oh, no, we're not going to go to Tayla, we're going to try and get even further ahead. I'm going to hog the camera. Come, Dave. Eyes up. Birds, birds, birds. Ah, yes, it is a vulture. I know about those vultures. We have already seen the white-backed vultures. We are looking for lapwings and lilac-breasted rollers and other birds we haven't seen yet. Not a lapwing in sight. Isn't that strange on the open areas of Cheetah Plains? Now, who's ready for the secret bird? Can you believe we're going to off-road for a bird? Of course, I think off-roading for a bird is perfectly justified. Let's see if you guys agree with me. Here we go, time to test Dave's camera work. Oh, it's gonna go behind us. No, it's going back that way. Testing my driving skills. Oh, Dave, this is gonna be tough for you. Oh, it's a speck. I don't think we're gonna be able to count that one. Oh, coming back. And behind us, of course. Wait, wait, it could zoom around, come over us, or go away. No, The turn, Dev. On the turn, there's two of them. There we go, you can just make them out there. Ooh, there we go. Ooh, it's running away from Dave behind the aerial. There was another one. Here it is. Oh, it's also going to run behind Dave. And anyway, well, I don't know. Did we see it enough to count it? But it was a red-breasted swallow. We'll try to get you another view. Final control says it doesn't count. But we are about 30 seconds away from the secret bird. Now, I'm pretty sure some of you have got the secret bird. But let's go into low range off-road for a bird. My goodness. Living dangerously this morning. What we will do to win. Shameless, I tell you, shameless what we'll do to win. Okay. Now this must be a really special bird we are off-roading for. I wonder what is going on. Dave, can you see the very special bird yet?
Not
yet. Me neither. Did we drive all this way not to see the very special bird? Did it leave before we got here? Michele says, in Johannesburg, is it a Cory bastard? Well, we're about to find out, Michele, if I can hopefully find it. Where has this very special bird gone? I think it's that way. So we've got some vultures near this very special bird. Off they take. I'm either being completely blind, or this very special bird has made a maneuver. I'd be very sad if we've come all the way here, and this very special bird has done a disappearing act. Give it another minute or two to find this very special bird. I got a feeling that Dave and I are being blind. So while we save ourselves some embarrassment, while we look for this very special bird, let's go see how Taylor's birding is going.
Hello, hello, hello. My birding is not going so well, thank you very much. Brent, I have been, well, actually, myself, Brian, and the Thumb have been bundu bashing this morning, and we do have to say thank you so much, Rexon. Rexon, you are a champion. Guess what he's found us? He's found us some lions. I don't know who or what or how many, but we're going to find out soon, hopefully. Thank you so much, Mfo. Is there anyone here? Oh, it's Aubrey there. Okay, thank you. Well done, hey? Well done, team. What a fantastic team we've got, don't you think? Please send in your praises. So I know that's exciting and I've sort of left you in the darkness a little bit, but we do have some form of lions. Which pride? I'm not sure. Possibly the Nkuhumas. I'm very uncertain and I also don't know them. So I know Aubrey's in the sighting. We're going to have to ask him. As well as I learn all the different cats of the Northern Sabi Sands, but I think we're getting there slowly. We've still got to bundu bash a little bit as we go around here. So it's very bumpy. Very, very, very bumpy. And I really need to get on with learning the property. But we're not doing too bad. We are managing. Oh, interesting. I've seen a lot of buffalo tracks as we're going through here too. I wonder if they've got anything. And I wonder if we're actually anywhere near to where we had those vultures this morning that were perched. We have to be getting warmer. Maybe I should shout out Marco and maybe Aubrey will respond with Polo and then I can find him. Vehicle tracks, where did you go? Which way did you go? Yeah? No? Can you see any fresh vehicle tracks? I was on them. Oh, they're still going. Oh, crikey. See, there's my Australian coming out in me. Ah, okay, we're gonna have to go here. Let me. Aubrey, you looking for me? Let's turn the vehicle. We're squeezing through. Ah, oh, that's good, son. I'm seeing some lion footprints, which is good. But now, where are the lions? Oh my goodness, I don't know where we're going, everybody. So I apologize. I'm just trying to concentrate very hard here. We can seem like we're going here. We're still just following vehicle tracks. Right, everybody, watch your heads. Turn the radio down a little bit. Wait, sorry, Ariel. Not too bad. I think we're just going to have to... Thank goodness for the short wheel. This is where we're going. Is it? Okay, we're almost here. We've just got to go through some bushes. I think let's go back to Brent. I just need to do a bit of maneuvering through here. And then hopefully I'll be able to show you some cats.
Now, here is the very special bird. It is, of course, an emerald spotted wood dove, Xivambalana. Well done, Aaron and Wendy, Xivambalana, the emerald spotted wood dove. Of course, he lacks emerald spots and feathers. But he is very fat and very happy. Now, this is only the second time I've ever seen Xivambalana. He is, of course, one of Karula's offspring. And here's the dominant male leopard in the east of Cheetah Plains. Now, the reason he is fat and happy is due to the drought. The drought has given Mr. Xivambalana a gift. The gift of a female buffalo that has died from lack of food and natural causes. So he hasn't even had to work for his meal. Now, he is a bit hissy at the moment. And that's because there's lots of hyena tracks around. It looks like the hyenas have left, or maybe he's chased them off. Let's just move back a bit. And we can show you where that carcass is. It's quite smelly. We're going to put ourselves... What we do for you... We're going to put ourselves downwind of the carcass so we can see both him and the carcass. Okay, here we go. The reverse safari. be able to see how big his belly is. But Xivambalana and the buffalo carcass are going nowhere. It seems like, just like yesterday, cat luck strikes at the same time. So let's go see what Taylor's got.
We finally got them, everybody. It only took us about 15 minutes of driving through the thickest of thick bush, but we have it. We have the Nkuhuma pride, which is fantastic. I can see all five females. However, they are hidden away, and I'm sure you are all desperately asking, are all the cubs here? I'm not sure. There are so many branches and logs in the way that I am uncertain, but there seem to be a lot of them around. So I think we've got them all. I don't know if those two or three little ones, I think it was, will do another. Apparently, sorry, I'm getting some inside intel. These are the three teddies. So I was just saying, I don't know if those other cubs are going to go on a walkabout again. I think they got a big scare, and I don't think they're going to leave Mom's side for a while, or be reluctant to leave her all when Mom says stay, go on a walkabout. So I'm very happy that they are, have been relocated, but they look relatively, it's so hard to see, I can't really see anything, but the females look like they've got big bellies from what I can sort of make out. So maybe they did eat something. Maybe we are quite close to those vultures that we saw this morning. Maybe there was a buffalo, maybe it was a kudu. There was a lot of buffalo tracks around here, and they did say that they had their tracks chasing buffalo around. So I'm not sure how big the buffalo was or what exactly they ate. I can only make a, or give a sort of guess, and I think it was probably a buffalo. And maybe the fact that it's not around here anymore, I can't see anything. Maybe it was just a small buffalo. Maybe they managed to snatch up a buffalo calf and they've eaten their fill quite nicely, and now they're going to relax in this wonderful Tambuti thicket. Ah, apparently it was a buffalo calf. Well, that explains why there is no carcass, because they all would have munched away on it and left hardly any remains. And that's what happens quite often when you see all the vultures like that, but then you go in and you expect to find a pride of lions or a leopard or something on a kill, and maybe the vultures already, the females had already actually got up and moved away from the carcass, and all that was left was the bones and a bit of sinew and some skin, and the vultures already got in very early this morning and munched away, and they've obviously moved off. So it was very much worth the bundu bashing to have my first ever glimpse of the Nkuhuma pride. They are so wonderful. Lovely females, lovely big females too. That's always important. The birding's not going so well. I think Brent could have actually caught up and maybe even taken the lead. I hope not. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed that a few birds come and swoop in here so we can have a look. Apparently Brent is on 18 birds and I'm on a mere 16. We cannot let him win. We cannot do that. This is my first competition with Brent, and I'm sure we're going to have many more fun competitions. Remember, these are just light-hearted competitions, so we're obviously all very competitive, but we won't cry about it if we lose. Who can I hear? I'm just gonna, I can see a sunbird. I can see a white-bellied sunbird straight above us. I don't know if you can get that. And it's gone. But there they go. Okay. I don't know if that counts. But we didn't get them on camera. But they were sitting directly above me, which is obviously very hard to get, and now they've flown off. But I did have two white-bellied sunbirds, but no one wants to give me the point, unfortunately. I'll have to do a lot of bribery and final control. I'm doing so much bribery. Right, while we hope for the cats to wake up, let's go back to the spotted cat that Brent has.
So he stood up, and morning ablutions are on order. I'm hoping he goes back towards that buffalo carcass. Let's see what he does. Apart from evacuating his bowels, to add
to the smell of a rotting buffalo carcass. We now have okay, where is he going? He's not going back towards the carcass. I'm going to keep with him. So, just up ahead there is the dead buffalo. Now, there's a lot of hyena tracks, so I think the hyenas have actually moved off. It could be from him. Certain male leopards can get very aggressive with hyenas. Oh, thank goodness, he's decided to lie down outside of the wind range. Oof! Very smelly female buffalo, there she is. So, died of natural causes from the drought. And Xivambalana has lucked upon this carcass, so he's managed to get himself a free meal with no effort, or maybe some effort from the hyena tracks I could see. Oh, it's a tired kitty. Shame. So full of buffalo. How's that, Dave? Look at that. Very, very happy kitty. I always think that the spots on a leopard's stomach get bigger the fuller they get as the skin stretches. And this is a very full leopard. It always amazes me how big cats can eat themselves to become uncomfortably full. There's no other way to describe it. You know, he's so full he can't close his eyes. My belly's just in the way, he can't lie comfortably. He's in a food grump. Hey, big boy. Michael's wondering, will I collect his scat? Most definitely. I actually think Xivambalana is one of the ones we're missing. And I have a scat collecting kit with me. There we go. Now, collecting scat is not for the faint heart. It is not pleasant, I promise. Leopard scat, lion scat is some of the smelliest stuff you'll ever come across in your life. But we shall collect. Now, speaking of animals that create smelly scat, while Xivambalana is in his food grump, let's go see how the Nkuhumas are.
The game reserve, which is situated in the Sabi sands of South Africa. And they're starting to stand up a little bit now, which is quite nice, because when you left us shortly, they were laying down and they weren't doing too much. We've got them laying down, but at least the little cats are coming through now. Here come the little fluff balls. Come and say hello to Mama. Look at them there, they're so lovely, craving that attention from Mom. And it's not uncommon as well though for cubs who don't belong to a certain mother to actually go and aloe suckle off another female. You see, lions are the most sociable cats in Africa, and that's why they're so successful. So it's quite nice that they do look after each other's little tiny cubs. However, I'm pretty sure Mom will show preference to her own cubs over somebody else's. But they're really, really fat. But it's really good to know that they have had a good big meal.
so that moms can all produce lots of milk for the little ones to drink up. They're basically eating like 16-year-old boys would eat. They'd clean you out of your house and home. They've just eaten, but they want more food. There we go. Lift of the leg and all the head squeeze underneath. One of the bigger cubs looks like it coming up. No, just going to lay down a little, not hungry just yet. So it's a very obstructed view. We're in a tamboti thicket at the moment. And tamboti trees, we don't want to sort of harm. We don't want to drive over them. So it's been very difficult to maneuver. But thankfully, with the precision and skill of Brian, he's managed to find us this little gap over here. And isn't it wonderful? They're very vocal. Can you hear that? I don't know. Maybe a little bit far away. Oh, feisty. Oh, someone's throwing a tantrum. And just remember, we are live. This is currently happening. So if you'd like to interact with us, you're welcome to either talk to us via Twitter, you can hashtag Safari Live at the end of your message, or you can email us at questions@wildearth.tv. I quite like that these cats don't want to sit down. It's giving us a little bit of entertainment. And that little one is starving, as you can see, with its big round belly. I love that noise. Here's a question for the viewers. What is your favorite sound of the bush? It can be anything from an insect to a mammal. What do you like to hear when you are in the bush? I'm trying to think what mine is. Let me just have a little think. I think it's actually got to be one of these noises that the little cubs are making. Little moaning, constantly chattering away. I also like the sound of the morning, of the dawn chorus. That's really beautiful too. So a combination of all the different birds. And on those really, really hot days in summer, when you hear the cicada beetles, that's quite nice too. Look at that one. Yes, I'm going to use mom as a jungle gym now. And a trampoline. Now jump, baby lion, jump. No. Maybe. We actually could get it. No, I'm just going to sit on you. I'm the king of the castle. You're the dirty rascal. I remember saying that to my brother growing up. Oh, yes. Come towards us. We're going to sit very quietly now. Maybe she's going to come make her approach. I'm going to remember the screenshots, everyone. Always good to keep taking little screenshots. You can hear me snapping away. That's me going to win the photo competition. Hello, lovely lady. You are beautiful. A stunning female. Really nice big cats. She's so relaxed. Look how close she is. Can you believe it? I mean, how ridiculous is that we are able to get this close to these animals? It's honestly ridiculous. Come on, little cubbies. Follow mom. Or have you been told to stay put? I don't know where she's off to. Maybe she's just going to find a better piece of shade, which is actually going to make for a really great shot. Yes. Lay down there and now call the babies. No, they're staying put. I'm wondering, though, if we shouldn't maybe reverse now before we get trapped in. Because otherwise we're going to get ourselves into a bit of a pickle. Going to reverse. Michael, I have to agree with you. I think a male lion roaring is an incredible sound. I forgot about that and I was listening to them one call last night. I'm very quickly going to reposition just because I don't want to get trapped in here with all these little ones. Like I said, there's lots of tamboti around us, so I'm going to try and just go back slightly. lovely noise, making me cringe. It's like nails on a chalkboard. We're gonna head back to Brent. I need to do a bit of maneuvering and I can't do two things at once this morning. See you later.
Well, speaking of maneuvering, Mr. Xivambalana has done the same, so we're trying to see where, has he gone to sleep on the other side? Yes, he has. He's found himself a little bit. Just move around. How's that, Dave? That's, here he is. So Wendy's wondering, will he try hoist that buffalo? Unfortunately, even for a beautiful big male leopard like Xivambalana, that buffalo is a bit heavy. It's possible he might hoist a piece of it, but I think the hyenas and lions might get there before. Go, big boy. So I don't think he's going to relinquish his spot next to this carcass anytime soon. He's moved into the shade of the termite mound, and he's going to rest here for the majority of the day. And yeah, eyes are closing. Maybe he's found a nice hollow to put his big belly in. Nancy's wondering, does a leopard's skin have spots or is it just their fur? It's just their fur, Nancy. If we had to shave him, he wouldn't look very nice. And it would have sort of a dark grey coat, so his skin does not have spots, it's just his fur. Of course the fur is growing out of the skin. Hello, big boy. Oh. As it gets warm, I don't think he's going to feed anytime soon with that massive belly he's already got. And I think we've got a few more bird species to just clock up, put it beyond doubt. And we'll definitely come back this evening, check on what's happening. Hopefully there'll be some hyenas here as well. We could get some incredible interaction between the two. Okay, so while we leave Xivambalana to process his massive buffalo meal, we're going to go back to Tayla with the wonderful Nkuhumas.
We have got the lions coming towards us, which is great. So we did a little bit of repositioning, which was a fantastic move and strategic, obviously, because we've now got the best position, which is fantastic. So we've got three females now that have moved probably about 25 meters, and I'm hoping that the next two females, oh, we've got a cub coming. We have got a cub on its way. It's going to go behind the vehicle. It's now mountain climbing over a few logs, but it's coming, it's running. So you're going to see it join up with the females in about 10 seconds, I reckon. Here, oh, I'm lost. Yeah, they're all coming. This is fantastic. Yes, call your friends. Call your friends. Their cubs are still coming. They're in a very awkward spot behind the vehicle, but they're coming. And we're going to have to be a little bit patient. They're calling each other, and their next move will be over to the moms. So don't worry, we'll get them eventually. I think the one little one that's awkwardly positioned itself behind my vehicle, which is very close, so I cannot move around. I'm going to have to sit very still. This thing is calling in the reinforcements to make a dash across the open to head to mom. No, don't do that. Go the other way. Okay, well, we'll watch these three beautiful big girls. You can see one's perked up and she's listening to or something. Look at that. That's actually a beautiful. Come on, guys. Snap away. Andrew from Lamont, I think that was. We have the same thing. This is definitely one of the most amazing. Vermont. I didn't hear that correctly. So Andrew, you and I both enjoy hearing the sound of lion cubs. It's a pretty amazing sound. It's very sweet, and I love it when they moan that row, row. I love that so much. I don't want to do it too loudly. Now the little ones have hidden away. I think they're gonna come across eventually. I think they're a little bit nervous because the three of the moms have just up and walked over. And then we've got still two of the other females laying in the Tambuati thicket with some of the cubs. And then we've got the other half of the cubs. Also, oh, hang on. We're going to get some action now because a fourth female is making her way over. And hopefully she will lead the cubs to the rest of the females. Maybe that is what they were waiting for. They were too scared to go on their own. Here we go. Baby number one. Hello, baby number one. You are very brave. We get the bravery award today. Sorry, just can you go again with the name Vularay? Am I saying that correctly? Bularay. Bularay. That sounds like a song. Fantastic. Bularay wants to know if I've done a count of the cubs yet. No, I haven't, because I've had a seriously obstructed view. However, as all the females come on out to the open, all the little cubbies are going to follow, which I will then be able to count them. But thank you so much for letting me know that there should be eight. So let's hope that none of them are lost. I did see quite a few of them moving around. So I think they're going to come on over soon. We're just going to have to be a little bit patient this morning. Look at that. I love that. 1 foot on mom's belly. Suckle, suckle, suckle. Find the teat that's got the most milk. Oh, little bum wiggle there. That's really sweet. Very nice. We've got another older cub going to make its way around, but it's now also plonked its bum behind the vehicle. Come on, guys. Build up a bit of courage. Build up a bit of courage and come on over like your sibling. They're slowly coming. They're slowly funneling through. Hello, little one. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. We've got another little tiny baby. These little ones, can anyone tell me how old they are? They look to be about 5 weeks or so, the smaller ones. And these ones slightly older, maybe about 8 weeks, if I'm not mistaken. But if you know the exact ages, please let me know. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. I'd love to know exactly how old the cubs are. Oh, yum. Yum, yum, yum. So thirsty. That's me taking a few little pictures for the photo competition. I know Brent said he had a leopard, which is lovely, and iconically posing on a termite mount, so I hope that doesn't work against me. But cubs often win. I hope I'm not being too arrogant. I'll have to look at these photos a little bit later. Look at that. Look at that. Beautiful framing. Beautiful framing. Lovely light coming through there on that little one's face. So far we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. And we've got a fifth one coming around the front of the vehicle. We're getting closer. We're getting closer. I think we may actually have all of them. Finally getting there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We need 2 more. Are you going to the toilet on your sibling's foot? That's nice. Who's that? Very rude. I didn't appreciate that either. Yes, go and pee back on it. No? You're a nice sibling. So we're still waiting for one more female. And I can see one more cub behind me. But it's very thick, so I'm sure there's another one that's just off into the distance. But isn't this fantastic that they actually moved out into the open for us? That was very kind of us. It's been interesting trying to get out of here though. So beautiful. I'm just taking a moment to take in the silence of the bush, the little birds all chatting in the distance. Lots of hornbills, the yellow-billed hornbills. Lots of yellow-billed hornbills making a chattering noise in the distance, which is quite nice. You hear the odd tawny flank prinia zitting. And of course the Natal spurfowls are often chatting away, guinea fowls, all sorts of different things. Thank you, Morning Glory, and a good morning to you too. Morning Glory, let me know that the first set of cubs were born in May. The next set, I think she was said, were born in June, and we're not sure about the teddy bear set. Does anybody know when the teddy bear set of cubs were born? I've got a notebook here today. I am going to very quickly make a note. Ah, okay, so apparently you started viewing the teddy bear cubs the beginning of July. It's hard to say because I didn't see how big they were. But if Mom had brought them to the pride. Ah, no, I don't want to go to Brent because he has got another bird. We're going to hang around with the lions and we'll see you in a bit.
Well, this is a beautiful little bird. I'm going to let you guys ID this one for me. Now look very carefully at the white circle around the eye. It's a very grayish bird. And it's a very grayish bird. Sorry, somehow I sounded a bit muffled. But look at the white circle around the eye. Now also look at the edge of the tail. And look if there's any coloration or if there isn't. Now I'll give you the family because it is an LBJ. Well, an LGJ, a little grey job, but it is one of the flycatchers. A little pair of them. So why don't you guys let me know what bird this is? And remember, questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live if you know the answer. What beautiful little flycatcher is this? I can hear some sunbirds calling. I'm just trying to see where they are. Okay. Just move forward a bit. I can hear them. Now, we had a wonderful sighting of a Mariko sunbird the other morning. So I'm hoping we can actually add a few more sunbirds. So I think the only... Our most common sunbird is the white-bellied, which from the sound of that call, now sunbird calls are very, very similar. It sounds to me like it's probably a white-bellied sunbird. Let's listen again. Where are they? Very high-pitched. Seems like they've moved on. So shall we. Now we're right on the southern edge of Cheetah Plains at the moment, and I'm really loving the fact the clouds have broken up. There's blue sky abound. It's going to be a beautiful Sunday here in the African bush. Ah, now we are coming up to a flowering
knobthorn. So there's a good chance there might be a sunbird in and amongst those flowers. Now, Marco's wondering, on the note of birds, I can hear a sunbird. It sounds like it's in the flowering knobthorn. If we get flamingos here. Now, there has been one record that I know of a flamingo that randomly arrived in the Sand River many years ago, but not normally. I can hear the sunbird. Okay, go up. Slowly, I can't see it, so we're looking with the camera, using it as our binoculars. I can hear them. Can you hear them, Dave? That tit-tit-tit-tit-tit. Maybe on the other side of the tree. Let's just move forward a little bit, see if we can catch a flicker of movement. Okay. Let's just look carefully now. They could be on the other side of the tree. We can definitely hear them. Now, the sunbirds are tiny. So sometimes it makes them quite difficult to spot. You see any movement yet, Dave? No, the sunbirds are proving difficult today. Now, we have some answers already for the flycatcher, and Gail, you are spot on. It is indeed the ashy flycatcher. Used to be called a blue-gray flycatcher, but that white circle around the eye and the lack of white primaries on the tail was what gave it away. There we go, an ashy flycatcher. Well done, Gail. Are we going to keep checking for birds and other creatures out here? We do have a slightly unfair advantage because Taylor is sitting with lion cubs. So let's go have a look. And now the sunbird is calling again.
Brent, thank you so much for acknowledging that I am now stuck with the lions. Not that it's a bad thing. I'm thoroughly enjoying this. We have actually had a few birds flying overhead. We're waiting for a bataleer to do a second loop so we can get a shot of it, but there is one up in the air, and there has been a pair of white-bellied sunbirds also fluttering around here, but they are, actually I shouldn't say fluttering because that means that they were maybe going slightly slower. They were racing around here, and I know it doesn't count unless we get it on camera, so we are going to be waiting in anticipation for those birds to come back. But look at that, doesn't the wonderful and comfortable. Brent, I think I'm going to win the photo competition today. Look at that. Snap, snappity snap. That is beautiful. Don't you think? Who agrees with me that that isn't that just the cutest thing ever to see a tiny little fluffy lion cub laying on its back? And I love the detail on its paw. Look at those little paws. Look how soft those little pads are still. They're lovely. And you can also see all the little spots on its body. Cuddle of lions. They all look very happy. So Michael, thank you so much. I'm going to very quickly add that to my notebook. You said that there are 3 male cubs and 5 female cubs. This is what Jamie and Brent apparently think, and they've seen them so often, so I'm pretty sure that they would be right. 5 female, very quickly writing this down, 3 male. And hopefully when they all come around, I'll be able to have a look for myself, all the little bits that make it unique. Oh, we've got one coming towards us. This one, this little lion cub to the left of us, is rock climbing. Well, not rock climbing, log climbing. What are you doing? Are you trying to sneak past us? No. Hello, here I am again. I'm just going to change. Don't sit there. You were climbing so nicely on the rock. Oh, typical. So now we've got 7 cubs. But I don't know where the 8th one is. There's still one female lurking at the back. Hopefully that other one is there with mom. James Richard wants to know if I have got a lion story for you that perhaps involves an elephant. Let me think. I have... It's a story, but it's not a lion eating an elephant. Actually, no, wait. I've got a few. I have got an elephant that had died of natural causes, whether it was a disease or whether it was from drought, or I'm not sure it was last year though, and we had a whole lot of lions come and feed on it, and there were about 50 hyenas at this carcass, and they managed to chase away these two big male lions. I've never seen male lions run like the way that they did from a huge clan of hyenas. I mean, it was an exceptional clan. So that was quite entertaining. And then another story I had, the one day I was watching a lion who was, this was many years ago, who was sleeping quite close to a watering hole, big male on his own. He was off trying to do territorial patrol, so he'd let the girls have a bit of a break from him. And anyway, we watched him, we watched sleeping cats, and most of you know that I hate that. I prefer to watch grass grow or paint dry and rather watch a cat sleep. So I was just about to give up when I heard some elephants in the distance, and it was a very hot afternoon, so I knew that they were coming down to drink at this dam where this lion was, and this lion had no idea that these elephants were coming. Anyway, to make a long-winded story short, the elephants chased the big male lion away, which was quite hysterical to watch as well. So it just shows you that size does matter in the bush. That's why I think the elephants are the king of the savannah. And here we've got another female coming towards us. And hopefully... She's coming straight towards us. Straight over, look at that, beautiful. Straight towards us. Hello, beautiful girl. Are you just going to come on over and say hello? Hello. Meow. I suppose they don't meow. And here she goes. No, there's a cruiser there. What did you want over here? Well, there's lots of straw thorns and things. Yeah, I wouldn't come here. And she's going across to the rest of the pride. Now we will be able to see if all the cubs are here. Yes, and I think we may have one, because I see another teeny tiny one, older than the one that we had come through earlier. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We've still got the original 6. Why are they all weeing on top of each other? My goodness, absolutely no manners. That is terrible. We've seen it twice this morning, and now I'm going to put my head in it. Oh, that's a lovely cold puddle of water. No, that's so ew. I'm so glad we as humans don't do that. Thank goodness for that. Wouldn't that be terrible? Lions. Okay, right, little ones, you need to actually move your bums and come on over to the rest of the pride. I can't see them now though. Okay, we've got one coming slowly. Woo! Brian has just confirmed we have got all 8 cubs here. Isn't that fantastic news? We haven't got any lions that have gone lurking and on walkabout. So that's wonderful to know. It's just that the other two are still lying in the Tambwati thicket. But I think they're slowly going to come over this way. Isn't that beautiful? It's really nice to see such a strong pride. Absolutely. And I love it too. Final Control says that they love this little one that's lying upside down. So do I. That's what I look like after Christmas. Christmas lunch. Big belly on the couch. watching some telly, possibly the nightmare before Christmas. Oh, that was very sweet. I should have been ready for that. Shame they're exhausted. So it's such a tough day for a lion cub. Have to eat the whole day and then sleep. Sometimes chase a few things around, annoy mom, and then sleep some more. See, all the lions I think are going to do today is they're really just going to chase the shade. You can see them up and sort of moving further into the thicket just to try and escape from the heat of the day. Wow, so lovely. Look how little you are. Where are you going? Are you going to cuddle mom? Yes. Yes, I missed you so much. Mom's saying I didn't miss you at all. She's growling a little bit. Don't sit on my face. Isn't this just wonderful? Farah? Say, please can you say the name again? Sorry, I'm not hearing the names as well. Farah. Sorry, a little bit of static. You want to know how the lions would react if in other places of Africa if they didn't know the vehicles. Well, they'd actually just get up and run away. They'd be very scared of us, very hesitant, and it's a very slow process, habituation. However, lions are actually very tolerant, and I think they're quite nice, and they do habituate quite easily. So it will probably only take a few months. You'd have to start off at a distance though, and just maybe even leave a vehicle there. If you know that if there was a pride sleeping like this, what I might even do is park a vehicle in the distance and just leave it there. Maybe leave the radio on so they get used to the different noises until they get up and move, and then go and fetch the vehicle. And then hopefully it'll give them an opportunity to the day then as well to come through, have a little smell, come and see exactly what we are, but not get upset by us, or because when we're in the vehicle we tend to move around a little bit, which we shouldn't always, and we talk and we make funny noises, and this can often deter them a little bit. So it's quite nice if you can just leave an empty vehicle with a radio on so they can get used to it. That's what we sometimes try and do if we find a den site of a leopard or a lion, is you go and you park a vehicle in that area and you give them an opportunity when they're ready to come out and check it. But yes, it is a slow process. But I think out of all the animals, lions are the easiest to habituate to vehicles. So we are very fortunate to actually be sitting here so close and to have all those females and those tiny cubs walking right past the vehicle. Ah, so we're very lucky. We're having a wonderful cat day here in Sabi Sands and Juma Private Game Reserve. We are going to go to Brent, where I think he's also got some lions.
From a picture perfect in Nkuhumas to the scraggliest bunch of lions I've ever seen in my life. There's only two of them at the moment. Two Styx cubs lying on top of each other. Oh my goodness, shame. They look so completely terrible. And there's also a Birmingham here. He's lying quite far from them. And no sign of any of the lionesses there. There's a big Birmingham boy. If I was him, I wouldn't let the cubs touch me. Shame.
Hi,
So Bart is wondering, how much water does a male lion drink? Last night he drank for over 13 minutes. Now Bart, male lions actually don't have to drink, but if there's water available, they will. Oh, scruffies. Oh, isn't that cute? Look like two little boys. Shame that their ears are looking really bad at the moment. Actually, their whole bodies. But saying that, they're still growing at a rate of knots. Look like they could eat. That is the lion pose of the day, for me at least. Now they're probably going to move into the shade as it gets warmer, and lying in direct sunlight at the moment. And it looks like moving is just too much effort. Where's the other one gone behind us? So the other one's moved behind us, directly behind us, or still lying down. Shame, these poor guys. It must be so itchy. Okay, well, let's go look at that big Birmingham boy. And oh, no, wait, look at that. Oh, that's it. There we go. Work the camera, little one. Sorry, I just need to be on the radio for a second. He's going to join the other one, I think. It's just... oh, shame, they are just so scruffy. Itchy, itchy, itchy. Michael's wondering whether the Styx will ever be able to overcome the mange. It is definitely possible. The type of mange they have is the lesser bad of the two. It's easier for adults generally to overcome, but I mean, these guys are growing. I mean, they look horrific, but I mean, they're not skinny. And they definitely don't know how to lounge like a lion. Now, of course, one of the biggest problems is with social animals, and with lions being social cats, is all the allo grooming, touching of each other. So, of course, things that are quite contagious, like mange, will spread between a pride quite quickly. And we saw that Styx lioness last night, and she's actually started to lose a bit of hair. But they don't look completely, if you take away the bedraggled mange effect, they don't look like they're unhealthy. Of course, try imagine them without mange. Their bellies are quite full. They don't look like they're about to starve. But of course,
having something like mange will affect their overall condition. Shame. They do have character, though. It's one thing I'll give them. Lots of character. Shame. Scratch, 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 scratch. You had to go join the big boy. He might go join the male. Nah, he's going to lie down. Okay, let's go have a look at the male. I mean, it's amazing that the Nkuhumas and the Styx, the massive difference because of this skin disease is incredible. Now, we've just had a good look at these slightly, I hate to say it, but manky-looking Styx cubs. Let's go back to the picture-perfect Nkuhumas.
Picture-perfect, you say, Brent? I think that describes these lions perfectly. I hope that those little Styx cubs do find some relief from their itchiness. But we are very fortunate to see these lovely, well-groomed little ones. Some of them are a bit fluffier than others. The other two haven't come over to join just yet. They are still lurking in the bushes behind us. We can't really see them too well. They seem to be quite comfortable, obviously, in the nice shade. The clouds have come over a little bit, which have now sheltered the lions. But they're going to have to move again soon, because the sun is always moving, and soon the shade that they are lying in is going to disappear. The little ones listening intently to all of us, all jiggling around in our vehicles, I suppose. Oh, coughing and sneezing, and quite nice. I wish I could have the eyesight of a lion for a day, just to see what they see. I mean, it's honestly incredible. I don't think we have any idea how great their eyesight really is. Imagine at night as well. Just being able to see so well. Come on, girl, give us a stare. Some of these female lionesses look quite relatively young. They look so healthy. So as well, I know I'm asking lots of questions from the viewers. Viewers, please help me out, seeing as I'm new to this area. How old are the various female lions in the Nkuhuma pride? Obviously, I don't expect you to give me exact ages, but an estimation would be very nice. And are there different individuals in the Nkuhuma pride that you know of? You know, I'm trying to see if there are any little identifying features on each of the females. Oh, look at that. Cuddle up next to Mom. Hello, Mom. I missed you. Mom doesn't seem too bothered. Amber eyes. Yes, I have heard of amber eyes. Let's see if I can find her, though. I'm not sure which one she is. I suppose she's the one with the very amber eyes, eh? I suppose it's all in the name. At the moment, they've got their eyes closed and not open very well. Just like that little one that's fast asleep. It's quite nice. But if any of you back at home think you can see which one is amber eyes, you know these lions better than I do, please let me know. It actually looks like we've almost got a two-headed lion, the way that those two girls were laying next to each other. Little cubs, still just sleeping. Mom's panting heavily from all that food that is pushing up on their diaphragm. And their stomachs and whatnot, so they're so well expanded, they can't take lovely, deep, long breaths. They're just little short, sharp breaths. But I'm so happy that we managed to see the lions. So it's another one that I can tick off of the list. This is the Nkuhuma pride. and one Birmingham male. Well, everybody, it's that time of the morning where I'm sadly going to have to say goodbye. So thank you so much from myself and from Brian and from the Thumb, who is so well dressed. And I hope you enjoy the Birminghams with Brent. Maybe see you tomorrow morning. Have a great day.
Here we go, a big Birmingham boy. It looks like he's been in the wars recently. Probably fighting for mating rights with his other coalition members. Now, it seems like Dangerous Dave and myself managed to pip Tayla with the bird quiz. Well, not the bird quiz, the bird competition. But of course, the photo competition is still in the air. Now, Tayla and I will both post before the sun sets safari, and we will judge on the number of likes on Facebook. I will put them on the Safari Live Facebook page, so everyone, you can vote there for the best photo of the sunrise safari. Shame. I can't help saying shame. I know I've said it so many times. They just look so itchy. Now, Boulare is wondering, would the mother ever abandon them because of the mange? It's highly unlikely, but it is possible. The only time she would abandon them is if she was under pressure for food and felt that having cubs was putting her life in threat in terms of her survival. So that's the only time that a female would abandon her cubs. So unlikely. So we're coming towards the end of the Sunrise Safari. It's been absolutely fantastic having you out there, and thoroughly enjoyed having a little birding compo with Tayla. And of course, lots of cats, which is always wonderful. Xivambalana, only the second time I've ever seen him. And of course, the Nkuhumas, two Styx cubs, and a big Birmingham boy who's getting upset with biting flies at the moment. You know, he's flicking his tail. So we're going to say goodbye from an upset Birmingham, but we'll be back here in a few short hours for the sunset safari. So from Dangerous Dave and myself, toodles!